बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। तो टुडेज टॉपिक रिगार्डिंग द हिस्टोपैथोलॉजी ऑफ एडिनेक्सल ट्यूमर एंड ऑल्दो दिस टॉपिक सीम्स टू बी अ लिटिल डिफिकल्ट टॉपिक बट आई वुड लाइक टू डिस्कस विद यू दोज एडिनेक्सल ट्यूमर्स व्हिच आर ऑफ क्लिनिकल सिग्निफिकेंस टू यू एज फार एज योर डे टू डे क्लिनिकल प्रैक्टिस इज कंसर्न एंड एग्जामिनेशन इज कंसर्न And I would like to, I have tried to make it as simple as possible. So let's start with those tumors which are originating from the hair follicles. So before we discuss the tumors, let's discuss the structure of hair follicles in the skin. This is a handmade sketch which very clearly makes you understand the different adenexal structures in the skin. This is a hair follicle, this tube. And a hair would emerge from this hair follicle. This is a hair. This is a hair which is emerging out from this hair follicle. Now, this is a eccrine gland. And you all know that eccrine gland would open into sweat follicles, which are different from the hair follicle. There is another type of eccrine gland, which are called as apocrine gland. These are the sweat glands, but they open into the hair follicle. So their secretions take the same route as the secretion of sebaceous gland, which are part of this hair follicle. So apocrine glands and sebaceous glands both open into the hair follicles, and their secretions move out through the hair follicle. However, the eccrine gland would open directly into the skin. Now, this is how the histopathological appearance of a hair follicle look like. This is a hair follicle. This is the hair bulb. And this is erector pili muscle. And this is the sebaceous gland. Point here to note is that the sebaceous glands open get connected to the hair follicle a little up superior to the place where the erector pili muscle is attached. The portion of hair follicle between the attachment of erector pili muscle and the sebaceous gland attachment is called as isthmus. And the portion of hair follicle which is superior to the place of attachment of sebaceous gland is called as infundibulum. So, isthmus and infundibulum. Isthmus is the portion of hair follicle between the attachment of erector pili muscle and sebaceous gland, and infundibulum is the portion superior to the attachment of sebaceous gland. This is the longitudinal view. You see this is the hair matrix from which the hair shaft emerges. Hair matrix is the germinal layer from which the hair shaft emerges. And if you follow this matrix upward, this matrix slowly turns into a hair shaft. And this portion of the matrix and this hair shaft is surrounded by two sheets, the inner root sheet and an outer root sheet. And outside the outer root sheet, there is a dermal sheet, which is made up of fibrous tissue. The bulgy portion of the hair follicle in which holds the matrix and the dermal papilla. Dermal papilla is again a portion of fibrous tissue, and in which the vessel enters and supply blood to this hair follicle. So this is the dermal papilla. So point to notice is the bulgy portion is called as the hair bulb, and the upper portion is called the hair shaft. Hair shaft is surrounded by an inner root sheath an outer root sheet and a dermal sheet. Now the cross section. This is a hair. The normal terminal hairs will have two portions, a cortex, which is the outer portion, and medulla, which is the inner portion. I will go into further detail once I will discuss the disorders of hairs in which all these structures are important. But here, since there are many adnexal tumors which originate from different layers of the hair follicle, so just having an understanding of the structure of hair follicle is important. So this is a hair, and surrounded by this hair, there is an inner root sheath and an outer root sheath. And then there is a dermal sheath. The first tumor which I am going to discuss, a benign lesion, which is called as a comedon nevus. This comedon nevus is just like a comedon which we see in acne. And histology is similar to a comedon. Comedon is basically a small epidermoid cyst lined by the epithelium, that which is of epidermoid cyst type origin. There are two kinds of comedons. These are the closed comedons, which we call as whiteheads, and these are the open comedons, which has connection to the surface. So the comedons are actually the miniature epidermoid cysts. So in comedon nevus, there are multiple comedons which are present from the early childhood, and there is no associated inflammatory lesions of acne. Trichoadenoma is clinically characterized by a solitary yellow nodule on a face. So it clinically looks like a solitary nodule. And in differential diagnosis, you would consider BCC hair, because it is a solitary large nodule on the face. Histologically, there are several keratin pearl-like structures, keratinocytes, many with thick epithelial lining. This is a midway between trichofolliculoma and trichoepithelioma. Both of these tumors I will be discussing. So the main structure of trichoadenoma, the main point is that it comes in the differential diagnosis of a solitary skin-colored nodule, like a BCC, and histology is very benign. There are a number of keratin cysts which are surrounded by normal epithelial structure. The cyst lined by stratified squamous epithelium. Keratinization is of, once you we use the term keratinization is of epidermoid type, it means that there is a stratum granulosum attached to this cyst lining. Trichelimomas are multiple skin-colored papules whose importance is that if you diagnose trichelimoma, then you ought to investigate that patient on lines of Cowden syndrome, which is characterized by very high incidence of breast, thyroid, and GI malignancies. Usually the Cowden syndrome present with multiple trichelimomas. A few trichelimomas will not warrant you to go into the detailed investigations of Cowden syndrome. There has to be numerous trichelimomas. Trichelimoma is derived from outer root sheath. And I will go back to the basic histology here. You see the outer root sheath comprises of cells with clear cytoplasm. And this also is seen in trichelimomas. Trichelimomas are characterized by lobules of small clear cells. And these are attached to the main epidermis. And these clear cells can be easily differentiated from the normal keratinocytes. These are the clear cells of trichelymomas. And these can be differentiated from the normal keratinocytes. These are small showing cytoplasmic vacuolation. That's why they give a clear cell morphology. Trichelymomas are characterized by a nuclear palisading, but there is no retraction artifact. Except this nuclear palisading, there is no similarity with histopathologically with BCC. Once you are in confusion, so the stain for trichelymoma is CD34. Remember this stain. CD34 stains these trichelymomas. One slide of Cowden syndrome. This syndrome is due to mutation of PTEN tumor suppressor gene. Clinically characterized by multiple trichelymomas. Other features include cobblestone appearance of oral epithelium, multiple skin tags, squamous papillomas and sclerotic fibromas, that is storiform collagenomas like we see in tuberous sclerosis. And I've already mentioned that there are three common malignancies which are associated with that: thyroid and endometrium and breast. Pilometrichoma, again a very common and important adnexal tumor derived from hair follicle. Clinically, it is characterized by a solitary papule or nodule, and since there are chances of getting calcification, so very soon this papule or nodule will give a chalky white appearance. You see this chalky white appearance. A solitary deep dermal or subcutaneous tumor 3 to 13 millimeter in diameter, head, neck and upper extremity. The lesion has firm to stony hard consistency and lobular shape on palpation. There may be quite short history. Malignant changes are very rare. The presence of calcium salt may be apparent. Lesion is benign, but there are chances of local recurrence. Pilometrichoma arises from the hair matrix. Now remember, what was the hair matrix? The portion from which the hair follicles emerge. So these are the areas from which the pilometrichoma, as the name signifies, it originates from the nail matrix, the hair matrix. Low power view shows the classical biphasic population. Biphasic means there are two different phases of cells. There is a outer rim of basaloid epithelial cells and inner core of pinkish ghost cells. These are the basaloid epithelial cells. And these are the ghost cells, the cells which show nuclear pycnosis. Their nucleus is lost and their cellular details are not very obvious, and the cells are merging with each other. These are the ghost cells. You can, you can say that they are the empty spaces. Empty spaces look like empty spaces. The cells are gone, the nuclei are gone, and they have created these empty spaces with faintly distinct cell boundaries. Very soon, this tumor, these ghost cell areas will show basophilic granular calcification. And sometimes later on, this calcification will become more prominent. So, point to remember in pilometrichoma, biphasic population. The peripheral basophilic epithelial cells and central pinkish ghost cells with indistinct boundaries and indistinct nuclei. Trichofolliculoma is a solitary papule characterized by protruding trichords. Trichords are white thread-like hairs. You can call as rudimentary hairs, not proper terminal hairs. Trichofolliculoma has a very characteristic histopathology. There is a large dilated follicle in which multiple small hair follicles are opening. You see, these all are hair follicles, and many of them are associated with sebaceous glands as well. So in a large hair follicle, multiple smaller follicles are opening. You cannot miss this histology, and it comes sometimes in the exam as well. Trichoepithelioma. After pyelometricoma, trichoepithelioma is again a very important adnexal hair tumor. Usually trichoepitheliomas are seen in the nasolabial groove and also in the centrofacial portion of the face, and are associated with multiple skin-colored papules. There is a variety, subtype, epithelioma adenoides cysticum. It's an autosomal dominant inheritance, and there are numerous trichoepitheliomas which present as skin-colored papules and nodules. The presentation of solitary lesion is that of a smooth nodule. If solitary, which is rare, then it is resembles a BCC. Multiple lesions are usually seen. Individual tumor reach a limiting size, but number may increase over the years. Trichoepitheliomas are derived from outer root sheath. Sometimes show connectivity to epidermis, but mostly this connection with epidermis is lost. So it is generally characterized by basaloid epithelial cells having keratin pearls in the center. This kind of keratinization is hair follicle origin keratinization. And if a cyst originates from a hair follicle epithelium, it is characterized by absence of granular layer. That is why once you biopsy the cyst on the scalp, which are called as the pilar cysts are differentiated from epidermoid cysts by the absence of granular layer. And similarly, these kind of keratin pearls or keratin cysts, which are seen in trichoepitheliomas, these cysts are devoid of the granular layer. So sometimes the trichoepitheliomas are confused histologically with basal cell carcinoma. So to differentiate it from basal cell carcinoma, we have to find a few differentiating histological appearances. The first and foremost is that the basal cell carcinoma always retain a connection. BCC always retain a connection with the epidermis. However, the trichoepithelioma does not have any connection to the surface epidermis. Number two, the trichoepithelioma have the peripheral palisading just like a BCC. This is a BCC. As far as the peripheral palisading is concerned, trichoepithelioma looks like a BCC, but there is no retraction artifact. Retraction artifact is the space between the epithelial component and the fibrous tissue component of the dermis. A space between the epithelial component of the tumor and the fibrous tissue component of the dermis. This retraction artifact is seen in BCC but not seen in trichoepithelioma. So the first difference between a BCC and trichoepithelioma is ये चीज जिसने ऑन किया अपना डॉक्टर सबाहत So the first difference between a trichoepithelioma and a BCC is BCC retains its connection with epidermis while trichoepithelioma does not have a connection with epidermis. BCC has retraction artifact, trichoepithelioma does not have retraction artifact. BCC does not have these keratin pearls, these keratin cysts, but trichoepithelioma has these keratin cysts. So these are the three major differences between a trichoepithelioma and a BCC. So sometimes you don't see keratin pearls, but you see this papillary mesenchymal body, which is an early form of hair hair bulb. This is the early development of a hair bulb. So sometimes you can see this structure. And this structure will help you differentiating it from BCC. CD10 is a marker by means of which you can highlight this papillary mesenchymal body and the surrounding fibrous tissue component of trichoepithelioma. Sometimes when there is no keratin cyst formation, trichoepithelioma is definitely confused with basal cell carcinoma. But a clinical difference is that it is quite rare to find a solitary trichoepithelioma. Usually trichoepitheliomas come in groups and bunches. So if there is a solitary trichoepithelioma, then it would make the life more miserable if there are no keratin cysts. So you have to sometimes resort to immunohistochemistry. This is a desmoplastic type of trichoepithelioma. Whenever you will hear the word desmoplastic in any tumor, it means that there is a strong fibrous tissue component of that tumor. Or in other words, you can say that the dermis in such kind of tumors is active and hyperplastic. Desmoplasia means increased fibrosis. Clinically, the desmoplastic trichoepithelioma or desmoplastic tumor will give a morphia-like appearance. It will give a sclerotic appearance because the increased fibrous tissue would make the lesion look more sclerotic. That's why jab bhi desmoplastic ka word use hoga, iska matlab hai ki lesion would be sclerotic. So desmoplastic trichoepithelioma would have the thick and strong collagen bundles between the epithelial strands. If these are the pink components are the fibrous tissue component, blue are the epithelial component, and these are the keratin cysts. So this is a desmoplastic trichoepithelioma. The tumor cells express EMA. These hair follicle tumors, they would stain with epithelial membrane antigen. Epithelial membrane antigen is taken up by the keratinocytes. So this is a very important stain in differentiating between a squamous cell carcinoma and a basal cell carcinoma. So BCC will never pick up EMA stain. So if we are in doubt, we can go for EMA. So EMA and BCC, EMA will not be positive, while in trichoepithelioma it may be positive. Then there is another tumor syndrome which is called as the Brook-Spengler syndrome. This is an autosomal dominant transmission characterized by multiple trichoepitheliomas, cylindromas, and spire adenomas, all adenexal tumors. Cylindromas and spire adenomas are acrine origin adenexal tumors. There is a gene related to Brooks-Spigler syndrome. Trichoblastoma. Trichoblastoma is a related hair follicle tumor, but it is usually solitary. And located on head and neck, trunk and buttock. Solitary nodule. And histologically, logically, it is characterized by basaloid kind of epithelial nest of basaloid epithelial cells. It is derived from germinative hair bulb. There will be peripheral palisading like in epithelioma, but again, there will be no retraction artifact, no connection with the dermis. In contrast to trichoepithelioma, the trichoblastoma will not be having the keratin pearls formation. So with BCC, the difference is that the nests and cords are totally intradermal, with no connection with the epidermis. And number two, there is no retraction artifact, but there are no keratin pearls formation. So if there will be keratin pearls, then it will be more towards trichoepithelioma. Trichoblastomas. This is a tumor which comes in the histological differential diagnosis of basal cell carcinoma. You can see it will give a very basaloid look here with peripheral palisading. You have to go for immunohistochemistry to differentiate it from BCC. Again, like trichoepithelioma, there will be a germinative hair bulb called as papillary mesenchymal bodies, which will help in differentiating it from BCC. So CD10 would be negative in BCC, while it would be positive in the stroma in trichoblastoma and trichoepithelioma. BCL2 is a proliferation marker, which will be diffused in BCC and absent in trichoepithelioma. There are other markers as well. CK20 is a Merkel cell tumor marker. Merkel cells are seen in trichoblastoma and trichoepithelioma, but not in BCC. Androgen receptor marker are seen in BCC. Cutaneous lymph adenoma. The significance of this tumor is only that it comes in the differential diagnosis of BCC. It is characterized by a solitary dome-shaped nodule. It is an uncommon tumor. So I have told you the only importance is that it comes in the differential diagnosis of BCC. So there is a considerable debate regarding its histogenesis. It is originally suggested that this is derived from immature pilosebaceous differentiation. While others consider that it to be an unusual variant of basal cell carcinoma or trichoepithelioma. More recently, lymph adenoma is thought to be a variant of trichoblastoma. So now the consensus is that lymph adenoma is derived from the hair follicle. That is why it is discussed in adenexal tumor of the hair follicle. It has a very characteristic histopathology. The basaloid cells, which are characterized by trichoepitheliomas and trichoblastomas, are seen only in the periphery of the lesion, while the most of the core of the nest is comprise of cells with clear cytoplasm, with clear cell population. So the basaloid ring is on the periphery in a form of peripheral palisades, while the most of the crust of this nest is comprising of clear cell population. So the immunohistochemistry is, it is S100 positive, Merkel cell positive, EMA positive, whilst carcinoembryonic antigen, CEA, highlights the ducts in any form of duct. So if CEA is negative, it means that this lesion does not have any ductal origin. Fibrofolliculoma. Now, this fibrofolliculoma is characterized by numerous pale facial papules. So the significance is nothing more than to add a differential diagnosis in case of skin-colored facial papules, like trichoepithelioma, like syringoma, the angiofibromas. So there are many other benign lesions which are characterized by skin-colored papules. So fibrofolliculoma is also one such kind of differential diagnosis. Histologically, it is characterized by a core of basaloid cells and surrounded rim of perifollicular stroma or fibrous tissue. You can see the fibrous tissue, and in the center there are the hair follicular epithelium in form of basaloid cells. It is not at all an important tumor. The only significance here was that it comes in the differential diagnosis of skin-colored papules on the face. As far as the treatment is concerned, you all know that these adnexal tumors are either excised surgically if they are solitary, because you would like to take a biopsy as well. And if they are multiple, then we can go for locally destructive procedures like electrocautery, cryotherapy, carbon dioxide ablative laser, plasma pen, etc. So we have reached to the end of adnexal tumors originating from the hair follicle. I would like to proceed to the adnexal tumor originating from the sebaceous glands. But I would like first to invite any questions if there are. Any questions?
Sir, can you explain the trichoelimoma again?
ट्राइकोलिमोमा की ना बड़ी इंटरेस्टिंग हिस्टोलॉजी होती है, क्योंकि ये जो ट्यूमर होता है ना ट्राइकोलिमोमा, इट इज कनेक्टेड टू द एपिडर्मस। ये डर्मस में अलग से नहीं पड़ा होता, ये बात जहन में रखें। ये ट्यूमर ना एपिडर्मस का हिस्सा ही होता है, और यहाँ पे आप अभी देखेंगे ये, दिस इज अ नॉर्मल एपिडर्मस, दीज आर द हेयर फॉलिकल्स एंड नाउ हेयर इज अ ट्राइकोलिमोमा। तो वही एपिडर्मस के जो सेल्स हैं, ये वो पोर्शन है हेयर फॉलिकल का जो एपिडर्मस से होके गुजर रहा है। तो इसके सराउंडिंग जो सेल्स हैं वो क्लियर सेल्स हैं। इसकी हिस्टोलॉजिकल अपीयरेंस क्लियर सेल एक एंथोमा से बहुत मिलती है, क्लियर सेल एक एंथोमा से, और दोनों के अंदर ये होता है कि ये दोनों एपिथीलियल ट्यूमर हैं, एपिडर्मस का हिस्सा हैं। देर आर क्लियर सेल्स एंड देर इज शार्प डिमार्केशन between these clear cells and the normal keratinocyte. बस यही इसकी appearance है। इसका हमेशा connection epidermis के साथ maintain रहेगा। ये epidermis से हट के नहीं हो। ठीक है? और CD34 is the stain which you would remember trichoepithelioma का वो stain, और अभी किसी hair follicle tumor का stain नहीं है। और tumors का है, लेकिन hair follicle में किसी और hair follicle का ये CD34 stain नहीं है।
थैंक यू सर।
So now the second part of this talk, that is the tumor originating from the sebaceous gland. This is a very common lesion which we see in middle-aged or elderly males. This is sebaceous hyperplasia or senile sebaceous hyperplasia or benign sebaceous hyperplasia. You may call it with any name. Again, characterized by sebaceous hyperplasia is a very common benign adenexal tumor originating from sebaceous glands, seen commonly in middle age and older individuals, can be called as senile sebaceous hyperplasia or benign sebaceous hyperplasia. It comes in the differential diagnosis of skin color, papules, and small nodules. Can be confused with BCC if it is solitary. Sebaceous hyperplasia, as the name signifies, characterized by sebaceous proliferation. And there, if you see closely clinically the sebaceous hyperplasia, there will be a small dent in the center. This is a small kind of follicle, the dent which is present in the center, a punctum. And histologically, this is the punctum. And in this punctum, the sebaceous glands are opening directly. This is a hair follicle opening in which the sebaceous glands are opening directly. They are now not a part of hair follicle. They are directly opening into that infundibulum. Otherwise, there is no other characteristic histological finding. Sebaceous hyperplasia. This is a nevus sebaceous. You must have seen this lesion in young individuals, seen usually from early childhood, and it fully developed, it gave a cerebriform appearance. Usually it would not give a cerebriform appearance, but it would be in a form of a plaque, which is a hairless plaque or a bald plaque on the scalp. The nevus sebaceous is characterized clinically by a bald plaque on the scalp with a waxy look in the center. Sometimes it will give a cerebriform appearance. Sebaceous hyperplasia, nevus sebaceous has a malignant potential, a high malignant potential. I'm not sure about the exact percentage, but it is around 10% of the tumors can turn into malignant. So if possible, always offer excision to the patient. Clinically, it is characterized by a large number of sebaceous glands, many of which are opening directly into the epidermis. And in addition to that, there will be hyperkeratosis, papillomatosis, and acanthosis. If there are no sebaceous glands, this appearance is very much like an appearance of a verrucous epidermal nevus. The only difference from a verrucous epidermal nevus here is the opening of many sebaceous gland into these directly into the surface. So with the presence of sebaceous glands, the histological appearance will turn into that of a nevus sebaceous. Syringocyst adenoma papilliferum, which I will discuss in my next talk, is an acrine tumor which originates from the nevus sebaceous. Then the third lesion, it is steatocystoma multiplex. The steatocystoma multiplex are the actual sebaceous cysts. The by definition, steatocystoma multiplex are multiple sebaceous cysts. The in the commonly we use the term sebaceous cyst to the epidermoid cyst. But the epidermoid cysts are not at all the sebaceous cyst, and you should know the difference between an epidermoid cyst and a sebaceous cyst in true sense. So this is a typical site of steatocytoma multiplex, that is the chest. And it can occur anywhere on the body, including the trunk and arms. The sebaceous cysts or the steatocytoma multiplex will comprise of a cyst lining, but this will not be a tense kind of cyst lining. It will be a collapsed kind of lining. You can see this is a cyst, but it is collapsed, and the sebaceous glands are opening into the cyst lining. Sebaceous glands are not part of epidermoid cyst. That's why if we use sebaceous cyst with the epidermoid cyst, it will be a misnomer. In true sense, an sebaceous cyst must have the sebaceous glands in the wall or in the lining of those cysts. This is a sebaceous adenoma. Again, the significance of this lesion is it comes in the differential diagnosis of a BCC. Sebaceous adenoma is usually a solitary lesion seen on the cheek. Clinically characterized by multiple lobules of sebaceous glands, the characteristic lesions are like a sebaceous gland, that is a rim of basaloid cells and a core comprising of mature sebaceous glands. It is a benign tumor. So this is a sebaceous adenoma. The sebaceous glands will have a bubbly kind of cytoplasm. That is the foamy or bubbly cytoplasm. You can see the cytoplasm look like the bubbles, soap bubbles within the cytoplasm. Sebaceoma is another related sebaceous gland tumor, comes in the differential diagnosis of BCC because it will give a yellow-orange look. Also comes in the differential diagnosis histologically with BCC. But the difference is you can find the sebaceous gland within these basaloid nests. These are the basaloid nests. Now comparing it with sebaceous adenoma, you see in sebaceous adenoma, the epithelial component is restricted to a narrow lining, and rest of the nest are comprising of sebaceous glands or mature sebaceous cells. However, in sebaceous adenoma, the epithelial component has surpassed or almost equal to the sebaceous component. Now you see lots of blue color cells. These are all the epithelial cells. And in the center, there are sebaceous components. So you can say the epithelial and sebaceous component is 50-50, or sometimes the epithelial component is more than the sebaceous component in sebaceoma. Sometimes cysts are formed, but these are not keratinous cysts. The importance of sebaceoma and sebaceous adenoma is again in making a diagnosis of a multiple tumor syndrome, which is called as the Muir-Torre syndrome or Torre-Muir syndrome. It's an autosomal dominant syndrome, which is characterized by loss of MMR protein, and it is defined as one of the sebaceous neoplasm and at least one visceral cancer. No family history is required. Sebaceous adenoma are more specific marker, while the next specific marker is a sebaceoma. So both sebaceous adenoma and sebaceoma are characterized by Muir-Torre syndrome. If you receive a report of sebaceoma or sebaceous adenoma, the next thing is that you should look for some GI malignancy or bladder or renal malignancy, endometrial malignancy, breast or hematological or intestinal carcinoma, cancer or an intestinal polyp. So GIT, genitourinary, breast and endometrium. These are the common malignancies which are associated with neoteroid. Only one visceral malignancy associated with a sebaceous adenoma is sufficient to call it as a Muir-Torre syndrome. So in today's talk, we have discussed a few familial cancer syndromes: Cowden syndrome, Muir-Torre, and the one with that
Brooks.
The cure Muir-Torre syndrome is characterized by the sebaceous tumors, which sometimes show cystic changes as well. Now, like any benign adnexal tumor, the sebaceous adenoma can also turn into a carcinoma. Usually the site is periocular region. There will be atypical population of cells which have a basaloid morphology, but in some areas you will be able to pick up these clear sebaceous glands having bubbly cytoplasm. And finding these sebaceous glands will help you making the diagnosis. Sometimes, you know, histochemistry is required to diagnose it. Sebaceous glands will pick up epithelial membrane antigen and will be negative for carcinoma, for CEA antigen. Sebaceous carcinoma, there is marked epidermal involvement. This has a poor prognosis. The poor prognosis include the multicentricity, more than 1 centimeter, poor differentiation, excessive tissue infiltration, and vascular and lymphatic spread. So it will be dead like any carcinoma with wide excision. So we will be ending our today's lecture on adnexal tumor by this, and we will be discussing the sweat gland tumors next time. Any question regarding the sebaceous gland tumors or hair follicle tumors? Nothing? That means it's, the things are clear.
Yes, sir.
Sure. Okay, then we are ending this talk today. Have a good night. Khuda hafiz.